Greetings, family and friends of St. Paul. Welcome to this week's virtual worship experience where I know that you're excited. And you want to know how I know that you're excited? It's because you are still here. And I've got a funny feeling and a sneaky suspicion that God is continuously blessing you. Yes, in spite of your shortcomings, in spite of your setbacks, in spite of a pandemic, God is still blessing you. And you know what? You ought to take time right now to give God some praise for everything that He is doing in your life. You ought to thank God for allowing you to enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. The scripture says, be thankful unto Him and bless His name. Woo! I feel it right now. I'm excited about worship on this Sunday morning. But listen, friends, before we go into praise and worship, before we go into this awesome worship experience, we want to prepare our hearts for what's about to happen. And I hope that you are excited about praise and worship. And I need you to do me a favor. I need you to subscribe, like, comment, and share this video with all of your friends, with all of your family. Now let us go to God in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you this day. We thank you, God, that we are still here in spite of what is going, in spite of what is going on around us. We bless your holy name, God. We ask that you clean us up right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, God. We ask that if you, that you search us, God, and if you find anything that shouldn't be, that you take it out of us, Father, that we can go into praise and worship with a clear mind and a pure heart. It's in the matchless name of Jesus that we pray. And the saints of God said, thank God and amen. Friends, follow me into our virtual worship experience. I'll meet you in the comments.
Bye. Good morning, St. Paul. Today's scripture will be coming from Numbers 13, verses 25 through 33. At the end of 40 days, they returned from exploring the land. They came back to Moses and Aaron and the whole Israelite community at Kadesh, in the desert of Paran. There, they reported to them and to the whole assembly and showed them the fruit of the land. They gave Moses this account. We went into the land to which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey. Here is its fruit. But the people who live there are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large. We even saw descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites lived in the Negev. The Hittites, Jebusites, Amorites lived in the hill country, and the Canaanites lived near the sea and along the Jordan. Then Caleb silenced the people before Moses and said, "We should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it." But the men who had gone with him said, "We can't attack those people. They are stronger than we are." And they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. They said, "The land we explored devours those living in it. All the people we saw, they are of great size. We saw the Nephilim there. They seemed like grasshoppers in our own eyes, and we looked the same to them." This is the word of God for the people of God. Let the people of God say, thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we come to you on this day, this morning. Father, we pray right now that you'll get whatever it is that stands in the way as you, your people, and your word are now about to intersect. Father, you want to speak something that is liberating, something that is healing. Father, you want to speak hope. You want to speak life into us. So, Father, as your people hear my voice, I pray that they hear you as they see me. Lord, I pray that they see you high and lifted up. Now, Lord, if you will, just let the words of my mouth, the meditation of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. In the name of Jesus, we declare and we pray. Let the church say, amen. Good morning, my brothers and my sisters. It's great to see have you join us and participate in our virtual worship experience here at St. Paul United Methodist Church. And I want to remind you that we are on this journey, this series we just kicked off, as we go through this. As we go through this, I believe God is seeking to unfold. God is seeking to liberate. God is seeking to inform. God is seeking to inspire. We went into this pandemic one way, but I believe God wants us to come out a completely new, profound way as we go through this. But I believe part of us going through this means we've got to ask some tough questions. And one question I want you to consider and just ponder, what lessons are you learning right now? What lessons are you, what are you learning about yourself as we go through this? What are you learning? Are you recognizing some things that you need to let go of, some things that need to get, that need to go, some ways of being, some attitudes, some dispositions, some behavioral patterns that need to go? As we go through this, what lessons is God teaching you? And what is he teaching me? What lessons are we learning if we want to come out of this on the other end different? Because you need to recognize that lessons are taught until they are what? Learned. And I don't want to repeat, nor do I want you to repeat some lessons of the past. When we come through this, we want to be stronger. We want to be a bit wiser. We want to have a lot more love in us. We want to have a whole lot more Jesus and God in us than we had when we entered. As we go through this, and as we continue to go through this, I want you to consider this thought as our springboard into today's text. And it is simply, who told you you can't? Who told you you can't? You know, I'm a big fan of trail mix, in particular the ones that have the M&Ms and the Hershey's in it, along with the peanuts, and it also includes the raisins. But I must admit, I am not a fan of raisins. I've never been. And when I eat the trail mix, I always take the raisins out of the trail mix. Well, the other day I was eating some trail mix and I was taking the raisins out, and it began to resonate with me. Who told me I can't or I shouldn't eat the raisins? Or why don't I eat the raisins? All these years, I have ignored. I have been resistant to trying the raisins. But I realized that day that I needed to do some things different as we go through this. And so rather than taking the raisins out, I actually started to put the raisins in my mouth along with the other mixed food in the mix. And lo and behold, I realized that the raisins didn't taste so bad. They didn't change the flavor, the texture of what I was eating. I recognized that this was not such a bad thing after all. Furthermore, I also noted that raisins had some nutritional value. You know, the M&Ms and the chocolate, as good as they are, as much as I like them, I know that they don't have the same nutritional value that the raisins had. And all I'm trying to articulate and say to us, who told you you can't? Who told you to stay stuck? Who told you to keep that same mindset? Who told you no? When God, the God we serve, is telling us, yes, who told you, you can't? And I believe this pandemic we're in, this pandemic has exposed some things. It has exposed the disparity and the inequities in our healthcare system. African Americans make up 14% of this nation's population, but a third of those who are hospitalized are African American. 70% of the people who have died in Louisiana are African American, but they only represent 35% of that state's population. 80% of the people who have died in the city of Chicago or African American, but they are only 30-something percent of the city's population. Over 40% of the people who have died of the virus in Michigan are African American, but they only represent around 14% of that state's population. And our Latino brothers and sisters represent over half of the people who are hospitalized in the city of New York, which is the epicenter of this virus. That unpacks and exposes the inequity and the disparity in our healthcare system in this country. This pandemic has exposed some things. It exposed that we were not prepared for this pandemic. The wealthiest country, the most powerful country, we have a very well-heeled healthcare system, but we were not prepared for this pandemic. This country, the wealthiest, the most powerful country, with its strong healthcare system, we have more cases and we have more people who have died of this virus than any other country in this world. It's exposed some things. And I want to drill down from the macro to a personal. And I just want to ask you, what has this pandemic exposed about you? What has it exposed about you? What have you not been doing that you should have been doing? What has it exposed about your faith? What has it exposed about your thinking? What has it exposed about the time, the things that we all take for granted? What has it exposed about you? The governor of New York, Andrew Cuomo, acknowledged that the coronavirus opened his eyes to the superficial interaction between he and his daughters over the past few years. And I quote, he said this, "Now I've got time to sit with them and really have in-depth conversations I hadn't had in a long time. I was missing a lot. They're grown up. They have complex lives and feelings and situations. They don't open up in a 4-minute conversation. There's a lot, a whole situation, nuance, frankly, I've been oblivious to. And I'm not going to let that happen again. And so I ask you, what has this pandemic exposed about you? Remember, lessons are taught until they are learned." As we look at today's text, Numbers, the 13th chapter, see, the Lord spoke to Moses and tells Moses to send a group of spies down to the land of Canaan, the land that God had promised the Israelites. And they spent 40 days surveying the land, the area. And they came back. And in today's text was their report and the outcome as a result of them reporting back to the Israelites. But understand, this text exposes Israel in this way, because those who occupied the land that God promised Israel, they were not Israel's biggest obstacle. Let me say that one more time. Those who occupied the land that God had promised Israel were not Israel's biggest obstacle. See, the Canaanites, the Jebusites, the Hittites, even those descendants of Enoch, they were not Israel's biggest obstacle, because they kept hanging on to this notion that they were grasshoppers, that they were weaker, they were inferior, that they were not able to take possession of this land. And I just want to know, who told them they can't? And who told you can't? What it reveals that, see, no one told them they were grasshoppers. No one told them that they were inferior. Somehow they bought into this idea, this notion, because they saw how big and how strong these people were. But that does not diminish their ability, because in whom they serve and whom they believe. Beloved, I just want you to understand that this thinking was self-induced by the Israelites, that they were grasshoppers and they were less than. That was self-induced. God never told them that. Even the people who possessed the land didn't tell them they were less than. They thought they were less than. Self-induced. How often are we self-induced into being paralyzed because out of fear? How often are we allow ourselves, our minds to get caught up in what was wrong or what won't work or how this cannot happen or so many obstacles that we cannot overcome? How often do we do that? That God, like he told Israel, he sent the spies to survey the land and get them ready so they could go conquer it. And they decided to run away from it, y'all. How often do we allow ourselves to be self-induced into this whole notion that we can't? Who told you you can't? When you serve a God who says you can do what? All things through him. And what that really boils down to is they, the Israelites, they stood in their own way. And I want to say to you on this Sunday morning, are you standing in your own way? God has given you dreams. God has given you ambitions. God has given you some goals. Even though we are in the midst of a pandemic, God has not stopped with what he has planned for you. Are you standing in your own way? And I want you to understand, my brothers and my sisters, there are obstacles. There are things that do stand in our way. Like this pandemic, it has come in. It's in the way. For Israel, they look down and they realize that there are groups of communities and people that occupy the land. Yes, they stand in the way. But that does not diminish, that does not defeat, and that does not thwart the plans that God has for you and He has for me. God is still in control, and if God is calling you to take possession, understand He's going to give you the provisions to do just that. That's the God in which we serve. But how many times do we stand in our own way? Not the obstacles, but we. Because who told you you can't? You know, we all right now, we are all having to deal with some lemons. Here's a lemon for you, right? Literally, this is a lemon. We all are dealing with some lemons right now. This pandemic has caused some lemons. And God is saying, I want you to figure out how to take these lemons and make some lemonade. How do you make some lemonade out of these lemons? But the problem is, some of us, we are so stuck on can't. We are paralyzed that all we can do is bite in. Into the lemon. And I now see why some of us still look mad. Some of us are so curmudgeon. If you are biting into lemon all the time, that's what's going to come out. And I want to encourage you to, on this day, to hold fast to the plans, to hold fast to God's unchanging hand, and to recognize, do not stand in your own way. If God's giving you some lemons, understand He's also going to give you some water. He's going to give you some other ingredients so that you can make some lemonade. You can take what was bad and make it into good. You can take what has hurt you and use it as fuel to move you into your destiny. You need to know and you need to realize that those things, those obstacles before you, cannot keep you back. But what can keep you back, as is evidence with the children of Israel, is the fact that we can stand in our own way. And I don't want you to stand in your own way. Get out of your way. Who told you you can't? Tell Him to get behind, because the God I serve says that I can, and because of Him, I will. But I want you to note this, and I'm finished. When we look at this text, what is so powerful is this very notion. Don't write off what God has already underwritten. Let me say that again, because that's one of those shouting phrases, one of those points that just make you want to shout. Don't write off what God has already underwritten. What does it mean to write off? It means that you have said no, you have decided that you are done, you're finished, you put a seal on it, you're burying it, you're not going to spend any more time on it, it is done, you're out of it, you've written it off, you've cleared the deck, it's no longer a plan, you're done. But also understand, when God underwrites something, that means that God is the sponsor. That means God has provided the resources. That means God is standing behind it. That means God has ordained it. He is supporting it. He is the person who is saying, go forward. God has underwritten it. So what that suggests to you and to me, if God has underwritten it, you don't need to write it off. And that's the case with Israel. Israel wrote this thing off. Israel, the report comes back, and rather than them saying, Caleb says to them, let's move forward. And the children of Israel, they are like, no, we can't move forward. Because they liken them to giants. And I want you to understand, yeah, there's some giants out there. But what Israel didn't think about was the fact that they have been dealing with giants all their life. They spent 400 years dealing with a giant called Egypt. Egypt was the giant of giants. Egypt would have been classified as the superpower of its day. And look what God did for Israel in Egypt. He liberated them. He got them out of Egypt. And they did not have to lift a sword. They did not have to use any weapons. They didn't have to fight. God ushered them out of Egypt. And he did it in God's own way. He brought on a bunch of plagues that caused this. Think about this. The Pharaoh was a hardened man. He was a mean-spirited man. He was so hardened about the Israelites that he even made it even more difficult. He told them to do work and did not give them the equipment to do the work. He was really trying to bring them down. He was trying to bring further hardship on them, and they were already enslaved. But that's all right, because God had plans. God knew he was going to liberate them. And so he brought on multiple plagues upon plagues, so many plagues that eventually the Pharaoh, whose heart was hardened, told the Israelites, just leave. Don't miss that. They were enslaved. Understand, they were part of the Egyptians' economy, free labor. And he tells his free labor to leave. Remember, in this nation, the United States, we fought a war to liberate slaves. And in Israel's instance, they did not have to fight a war. They literally were given the door and said to exit. See, and what the Israelites didn't recognize in the moment where they were looking over the land of Canaan, that God had already underwritten that moment. God had underwritten it when he got them out of Egypt. God had underwritten it when he led them through the past the Red Sea and Pharaoh's army drowned behind them. God had already underwritten all this specific moment. And I just want, but they didn't fully capture that. But if God had liberated them out of the Egyptians' hands, who were classified as the giants of giants, don't you know that God was going to do the same in this situation? He could liberate them from the Hittites, from the Jebusites, from the Amorites, from the Canaanites, all of those ites. He could get out of their way because that's who God is. And I just want to share with you on this Sunday morning that that's the same God we deserve. God is underwritten. If he underwrote the moment for Israel, I want you to know that he's underwritten this moment for you and me. He's underwritten this moment. This pandemic, it's already been underwritten. This thing you're going through, it's been underwritten. And it's been underwritten a long time ago. When he sent his son Jesus Christ, he was underwriting this moment. When Jesus took that cross and carried it up Golgotha, he was underwriting the moment. When Jesus got hung on that cross and they pierced him in the side, they put nails in his hand and in his feet, he was underwriting the moment. I think I'm preaching right now. When they put a crown of thorns on his head, he was underwriting the moment. When Jesus said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit, what was he doing? Underwriting the moment. When Jesus gave up the ghost and he died on the cross, he was underwriting this moment. When they put him in a borrowed tomb, he was underwriting the moment. When Jesus stayed in that borrowed tomb on Friday night, when he stayed in that tomb on Saturday and Saturday night, he was underwriting the moment. And when they got up and went to the tomb to prepare Jesus's body, the women did, and they realized that he was gone. The moment had been underwritten because he got up with all power in heaven and earth in his hands. He underwrote the moment. He's underwriting your situation. He's underwriting my situation. He's underwriting our pain. He's underwritten our struggle. He's also underwritten our victory. He's underwritten our joy. He's underwritten the journey that we're on. He's underwritten the hope that we'll possess. He's underwritten the power that he'll give us. He's underwritten everything. Understand, my brothers and my sisters, that's why you don't need to write this thing off, because it's already been underwritten by our God. Hallelujah. He's underwritten, so you don't have to write this thing off. Who told you you can't? I want you to know that if Jesus paid it all, in other words, God underwrote it because of Jesus, No one can tell you you can't. Yes, you can. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Yes, you can. Because you may walk through the valley of the shadow of death, but you don't have anything to fear. Because of what? God has already underwritten this thing. And I praise God right now for his power and his love. And that we know that this moment that we're in, as painful, as challenging, as daunting as it is, it has already been underwritten. So child, I don't want you to write things off. Don't write off his love. Don't write off the plans that he has for you. Don't write off his grace. Don't write off his peace. Don't write it off. Just allow yourself to fall into his arms and let him carry you through this moment. Let us pray. Father, I thank you right now for this moment. Thank you that you sealed it all. You confirmed it all. You underwrote it all when you gave it all and left it all on the cross. So I pray for every need, every concern, every care. I lift your people up to you right now. Have your way in their lives and in their situation. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. My friends, I want to extend this moment of decision to you. I don't know, maybe you've never accepted Jesus into your life. On this day, I want to offer Jesus Christ to you. The Word of God says that if you will simply confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised his Son, Jesus Christ, from the dead, that you have salvation. That's all you need to do. You have it. And if you also looking to be connected to a community, a body of believers, I want to offer St. Paul for you to be connected, have a place that you can call home. In the midst of this pandemic, you need to be connected to community. And maybe you just need prayer. But if you stand in one of those positions, I want you to go to our website, and that is www.spumcd.com. And I want you to click on prayer and then articulate your need. If you want to accept Christ, you need prayer, you want to become a part of our congregation, you articulate that and we will get back to you. And that's where our journey together will begin. God, I claim right now the victory on all of those who are making decisions on today. We claim it. Now, God, we want to live it. In your name we pray. Amen. Greetings, my St. Paul family. Just wanted you to know what Pastor Butler has been involved in the community as it relates to the coronavirus. I am serving on several task force and advisory groups, working with our public officials to make sure that they have the insight from the community and community leadership as they make decisions that impact us during this pandemic. So note that we are helping to provide leadership in areas so that your voice is represented and our community is heard. I also want you to know that we launched an initiative called We Need to Survive because we recognize that this pandemic would impact the African American community disproportionately than others. And so the We Need to Survive campaign includes our own state representative, Retta Bowers, our own Terry Allen, who is on the board of the National Association of Black Journalists. We have gathered media representatives along with clergy to really push this effort to get the word out around being proactive around prevention so that we can reduce the number of African Americans who are being infected by the virus and ultimately try to reduce the number of deaths of people of color. So know that we have been involved in that effort as well, and we'll continue to push that specific theme. We need to survive. So I want to encourage you to shelter in place. I want to encourage you to continue to social distance because it impacts people of color disproportionately. We need to be that much more proactive around our health and our safety. So this is really what I call a COVID-19 update from your pastor. Continue to be safe, shelter in, take care, and be blessed.
Who told you you can't? Friends, we are absolutely excited that you decided to worship with us this Sunday morning. And I pray that something touched you today. I pray that the praise and worship moved you. I pray that the word resonated with you. And friends, before we get out of here, I want to remind you that St. Paul still needs your support. And you can support St. Paul by going online and giving online at www.spumcd.com. Again, that's www.spumcd.com. And there are other ways that are listed below your screen on how you can give. Now, up next are our announcements. And if you want to be in the mix with what's going on with St. Paul, stay tuned for the announcements that is to come. Until I see you next week, same bat time, same bat channel. Take care and be blessed.
Good morning, St. Paul, and a special hello to our guests and friends. Here's news and information you can use for this week that can help you get connected and grow right here at St. Paul. Mother's Day is coming up, and the Children and Youth Ministry are planning a special tribute. Moms, please send in your photos so that you can be a part of this amazing celebration tribute. Email your picture to Pastor Nuke at spumcd.com. Calling all St. Paul High School and College graduates. If you will be a 2020 graduate this May, please send your information to the church office, including your photo. Also, St. Paul, join the Children and Youth Ministry for a special graduation recognition fundraiser for our 2020 graduates. We are asking everyone to donate $25 to purchase personalized graduation recognition yard signs so that we could blanket our senior homes with signs of encouragement from their St. Paul family. You can make your donation at spumcd.com. For information, call the church office for details. With 6 feet distancing and dressed in protective gear, the Body and Soul Ministry and its amazing volunteers are continuing to serve our city's homeless population. While we are still not able to serve the homeless in our traditional seated environment, we are providing bagged meals and other items. Thanks to Ms. Leah Parker and her team for amazing leadership. There are a myriad of opportunities for you to stay spiritually fit as we continue to grow together in God's Word. Spiritual conditioning opportunities include Midday Manna, Wednesday Night Alive, Men and Women's Bible Study, Youth and Children Programs, and of course, prayer. To learn how you can connect, visit spumcd.com or look for a text message or email for details. If you are not receiving emails or text messages, please contact the church office and get added to the database. Kick back and chat with Pastor Butler. Join the virtual Zoom happy hour each Tuesday and Thursday from 6:30 p.m. to 7 p.m. Starting this Tuesday, visit our website at spumcd.com and click on the virtual happy hour graphic to register. Pastor Butler says, let's have some fun, no agenda, just kick back, chat, and check in. Oh yeah, don't forget to bring your favorite drink to the happy hour. St. Paul is planning our own quarantine house party events. Stay tuned for an old school house party. Yeah, that's right. Get ready to push the furniture back and get your line dance moves ready for May the 1st. And keep the furniture moved back so you can indulge in some salsa dancing for our Cinco de Mayo house party on May the 5th. And for you new school hip hop types, you're not left out. Stick around and mark your calendar for May 8th for a new school house party. Stay tuned to our social media, website, text messages, or e-blast for more details. To learn more about the happenings of St. Paul, please visit our website at www.spumcd.com. Thank you for your attention and have a blessed week.